It can be hard to describe the complex differences between the Great Pyramid and the Step Pyramid of Djoser. Djoser the King predates an established timeline of Khufu the King by roughly 80 years at an estimate, yet the complex architectural indifferences are literally mind-numbing. If we were to accept that these kings were builders of pyramids, then the advancements in engineering must have been learned at Saqqara shortly before the construction of the Great Pyramid at Giza, and then it was never replicated. Well, it may have been replicated at Abu Rawash, but that will never be realized for obvious reasons. This is the Lost Pyramid, the most northerly pyramid in Egypt. In Egypt in the 1830s, the ruler Muhammad Ali spent years trying to industrialize and modernize his country. He approved a plan put forward by his European engineers to build a dam across the Nile Delta to aid irrigation for farming. Concerned about obtaining construction material, Muhammad Ali realizes there is an abundant source of already quarried and worked stone in the form of the pyramids of Giza. Muhammad Ali's proposal is to demolish the pyramids. One of Muhammad Ali's officials, the engineer Joseph Hekekian, had some years earlier written in his journals about the possibility of using some of the pyramid stones for building projects. In February of 1836, the French political theorist and social reformer Prosper Ousselton reported that the Pasha had set a committee to study the pyramids, and in the following months it was reported in newspapers and journals throughout Europe and America that the Egyptian government was planning to dismantle the pyramids for the barrage, and that the Egyptians later abandoned this plan. 700 years earlier, there was an effort by an army to do this very thing at the Menkaure Pyramid. 8 months of stripping reduced the Great Pyramid to the state they are in today, and this was probably the fate of the Abu Rawash Pyramid. Being more northern than the other pyramids meant it was easier to access for this purpose. The Lost Pyramid of Abu Rawash would have been constructed about the size of the Menkaure Pyramid, but taller than the Great Pyramid because of the elevation it was constructed upon. Some say it was never completed in the first place, but the evidence shows it was probably stripped for the stone materials that were readily available. These ancient monuments must date to the previous age of existence, the age of the unknown. We say this because there is a complete separation between the people who built structures in Egypt and even in Britain. The stone circles of Britain may be linked to the gods of ancient Egypt, which we'll be discussing in our Great Pyramid series later on. But an interesting fact about the stone circle of Britain, including the most famous one at Stonehenge, is the fact that the very first settlers in Britain in a pre-Roman world were the Celts. And when they arrived on British soil for the first time, they tell us that the Stonehenge was already there in the state we see it in today. That was about 3,000 years ago. It has hardly changed since the first accounts of the people, yet we were expected to believe this was only 2,000 years old when these people discovered it. Stonehenge, like the pyramids, were designed to survive the ages. There is no doubt about it, and one mind-boggling fact about this monument is that it appears to represent the planets of the solar system, including Pluto. You heard us correctly, guys. At this place, the solar system is accurately represented. What is that all about? We didn't even know it would have marked the solstice until 1906. We are finding these things all over the place, and we do not know what they are for. Mercury and Venus are the two planets in the sky that keep in closest association with the sun. The eastern and northern lowest trilithons have alignments through the Sar-Sun circle relating directly to the sun. Therefore, this suggests that these two lowest trilithons represented Mercury and Venus. The two intermediate trilithons represented Mars and Jupiter because they are associated with lunar alignments. Mars and Jupiter are associated with the moon due to their pass through the zodiac. Because of this, they are not linked to sunrise and sunset events like Mercury and Venus, but may be observed close to the moon as they all follow similar paths along the ecliptic. The two intermediate trilithons align with major and minor positions of the moon, which the altar stone, stone 80, also does through gaps in the Sar-Sun circle. The Great Trilithon represented Saturn because Saturn moves very slowly across the sky compared to the other four planets. This stately pace may have indicated to the people who built Stonehenge that Saturn held some sort of senior position in the heavens. Saturn, of course, has been represented as the ancient central sun. Stonehenge has received more attention from would-be analysts than any other ancient monument, with the possible exception of the Great Pyramid. Archaeologists have seen it as a great communal ritual center, serving the several cultures who successfully occupied it, including the Romans, who adopted it for worship of the god Apollo. Much work has been done, but still the argument has flowed between those who deny the builders were anything more than a society with an ability to chip stone and organize work gangs, and those who see evidence of considerable knowledge of geometry, geodesy, and astronomy, and of a particular capability to express that knowledge on the landscape. The builders of these ancient things did leave us a message, one in which we were yet to realize, and the timeline of when the very ancient things were constructed is simply unknown, and we certainly shouldn't keep pushing the 5,000-year timeline. These things went up in the previous wave of existence to warn us. They built these things in key areas of our planet that, when realized what they are, they can also be reconstructed and reused. Many ancient ruins demonstrate that the people who constructed them had not only a special regard for celestial bodies and mathematics, but also a spot on accuracy. From Egypt to Mexico, there is no doubt that past civilizations were involved in incredibly complex space calculations, mathematics, and architectural endeavors. Stonehenge, with some stones weighing in excess of 70 tons, the Neolithic monument has inspired many to suggest it was a model of the solar system that also functioned as some sort of ancient machine that appears somehow linked to the Great Pyramids. The local stories say that people have been gathering at Stonehenge at midsummer back into the midst of time. But it wasn't until 1740 that William Stukeley noted that the avenue answers, as we have said before, to the principal line of the whole work, the northeast, whereabouts the sun rises when the days are longest. Subsequent authors, including Dr. John Smith in 1771, made the incorrect assumption that it was the heel stone itself that marked the position of sunrise on the longest day, the 21st June. In reality, the heel stone is not exactly in the middle of the avenue. It's offset to the east, and so it doesn't indicate where the first gleam of the sun appeared over the horizon 5,000 years ago. Back when Stonehenge was built, the Earth's axis was tilted over slightly more than 24 degrees instead of 23.5 degrees it is today. The difference means that originally the sun would rise much further to the left of the heel stone than it does today, but about two whole sun widths in reality. When conditions are perfectly clear, the heel stone casts a long shadow that penetrates the Sarsen circle through the main entrance, without the trees which now distort the horizon and the change in the Earth's tilt. This shadow effect would have been far more noticeable 5,000 years ago. Some have chosen to see this as the symbolic fertilization of the Earth goddess by the Sky God. Whatever the truth of that interpretation, it's certainly the case that 9 months afterwards we reach the vernal equinox and the rebirth of the land in springtime. Archaeologists now firmly believe that this was the winter solstice sunset that was the important time of year for the builders of Stonehenge, and this is in exactly the opposite direction to that of the summer solstice sunrise. When viewed from the center line of the avenue next to the heel stone, the sun on the shortest day, around the 22nd of December, would have been seen to set in the southwest between the upright of the tallest trilithon stones at Stonehenge. The fact about Stonehenge and the pyramids is the fact that 5,000 years ago, we were not equipped to do this. We did not have the know-how to understand such tasks until many thousands of years after they were said to have been constructed. This overwhelmingly suggests that either an advanced understanding existed that was then lost in society, or that these very ancient things predate this wave of human existence and indeed human understanding in general, but what do you guys think about this? Comments below, and as always, thank you for watching.